for our subject here this afternoon is on the marriage. It probably is going to be kind of controversial for some of you to listen to what is written and contained in God's Word. So you take this and look these verses up. I'll try to repeat them very carefully. And we need the Holy Spirit's presence. We do not have the Holy Spirit as in His presence among us as a people. We have avoided this. So we need to pray for that He will return to us and lead us into all truth. This subject now, I would like to have you turn with me to Genesis chapter 2. And let's see right from the beginning what we can expect. Genesis chapter 2, and I'm going to read from verse 18. And then I'm going to read from verse 23 and 24. And the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet for him." And verse 23 and 24. And Adam said, "This is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was made out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh." Now, brothers and sisters, this is written so that the Lord has provided that we have an unerring rule. I'm going to probably read this this quotation, maybe even more than this once. It's found in Spiritual Gifts, and it's book 3, and it's Facts of Faith. It's towards the back of the book. "It is dangerous business in the service of God to deviate from His institutions." Now, we understand that His institutions is the marriage and the Sabbath. So it's dangerous business to deviate from His institutions. Those who have to do with God, who is infinite, who explicitly directs in regard to His own worship, should follow the exact course He has prescribed and not feel at liberty to deviate in the smallest respect because they think it will answer just as well. God will teach all His creatures that He means just what He says. Well, probably the easiest way for me to approach this with you is to start with the ministry. Because we find that there is a lot of confusion now. Actually, it really comes right from the ministry. And I'll read another quotation in just a moment. But let's turn to 1 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 3. And let me see what we got. And it's chapter 3, and it's verse, I think maybe I'll read from verse 1 and down to verse 3. "This is the true saying: if a man desires the office of a bishop, he desires a good work. The bishop then must be the husband, he must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, and apt to teach. Not given to wine, not no striker, nor greedy, or filthy looker, but patient, not a brawler, or covetous. It goes on in the same verses, in the same chapter, and it goes on to about verse 11 and 12. I'll read from verse 10. Let those who be first proved, then let them use the office of a deacon, being found blameless. Even so must their wives be grave, not slanderers, sober, faithful in all things. Let the deacon be the husband of one wife, ruling their children and their own house well. If I make a mistake in reading, please forgive me. My eyesight has failed me very badly. And the lighting here is not really that good. So, we understand now that the institutions should be very, very well preserved. We understand the Sabbath, and we're going to understand the marriage relationship. I'm going to turn a couple of pages back, and we'd like to read in Titus. And it's chapter 1, and it's verse 4 through 8. To Titus, mine own son, after the common faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. For this cause left I thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city, as I have had appointed thee. If any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly, but a bishop must be blameless as a steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, no striker, nor given to filthy lucre, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate. Well, we've covered now the bishop, that's the elder. We've covered the deacon, and we also covered the elder here in Titus chapter 1. Let's to use now an Old Testament. I would like to have you turn with me to Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes, and I think at first it's chapter 9. Ecclesiastes chapter 9. And verse 9. Live joyfully with the wife whom thou lovest all the days of thy life. Of thy vanity which he hath given thee under the sun, all the days of thy vanity, for this is thy portion in this life, and in the labor which thou takest under the sun. Joyfully with the wife? Maybe that says something to us. Young people, do we take the time to become acquainted with our chosen pen companion? Do we watch their characteristics? Do we watch their honesty? these qualifications, remember now, we're going to go through life with them. I might show you a little something here. It's a spirit of prophecy, and it's book 1, and it's 111. Book 1 and 111. And I'm going to compare this with an older book also. There are many unhappy marriages because so much haste. Two unite their interest at the marriage altar by most solemn vows before God without previously weighing the matter and devoting time to sober reflection and earnest prayer. Many move from impulse. They have no thorough acquaintance with the disposition of each other. They do not realize that the happiness of their lives is at stake. If they move wrong in this matter, and their married life proves unhappy, it cannot be taken back. If they find they are not calculated to make each other happy, they must endure it the best they can. Now, when we read things, we have a tendency to accept things just as they're written in a book. But if you watch real closely and compare the writings that we have trusted so much, I'm going to give this a comparison. It's on page 120 in book 3 in Spiritual Gifts. Now, this is just an illustration. Book 120, and it's in page, this is just a little bit harder to find the page, and it's not in sequence. Yes. Now, I'm going to read this, and you compare it with your books. I think the word changes here is tremendous. What a contrast to the course now pursued by parents and children. There are many unhappy marriages because of so much haste. Two unite their interest at the marriage altar by the most solemn vows before God without previously weighing the matter and devoting time and sober reflection and earnest prayer. Many move from impulse. They have no thorough acquaintance with the disposition of each other. They do not realize that the happiness of their whole life is at stake. Did you notice that word? That has been removed from the Spirit of Prophecy, Book 1. It just says their life is at stake. Here it says, their whole life is at stake. If they move wrong in this matter, and their married life proves unhappy, it cannot be taken back. If they find they are not calculated to make each other happy, they must endure it the best they can. Well, you know, I was married for 66 years, and I had ups and downs, and my wife did too. Perhaps things I did, but was not quite right, that she saw was right. But we was able to pray about it and get our differences ironed out. And truly, we realized that our whole life was at stake. The happiness of our whole life, I should say, was at stake. And we were able to endure this marriage relationship now was 66 years, and she passed away. So it's been quite a heartache for me. Let's take a New Testament verse now. Last time where it's going to be Matthew, and it's chapter 19. Matthew chapter 19. Matthew chapter 19. And I'm going to read here verse 6. Wherefore, they are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let no man put asunder. Is it strange that we can read these verses and still have problems? We're trying to get to the kingdom. And I just read to you that God means exactly what he says. There's no other way. And we have to come into line. I think I would like to read again spiritual gifts, and it's on page on 99 and 100. It's just a few pages alone here. It's 99 and 100. In the beginning, God gave to Adam one wife, just showing his order. He never designed that man should have a plurality of wives. Lamech was the first who departed in his respect from God's wise arrangement. He had two wives. Now I'm going to turn the page. Now 100. The Lord said to Noah and his family, who were saved in the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation. Noah had but one wife, and their united family discipline was blessed of God. Because Noah's sons were righteous, they were preserved in the ark with the righteous father. God had not sanctioned polygamy in a single instance. It was contrary to his will. He knew that the happiness of man would be destroyed by it. That is only one wife. Luke chapter 16 and it's verse 18. Luke chapter 16 and it's verse 18. Whosoever putteth away his wife and marrieth another committeth adultery, and whosoever marrieth her that is put away from her husband committeth adultery. That's pretty plain, isn't it? I tell you, it's a sad situation here that we're facing. The quotation I read just a little bit ago on the facts of faith, I think I'll read it again. And it's the second section of facts of faith, and it's page 14 and 15. I haven't memorized this, but I won't try to quote it now. As the second section, facts of faith. It is dangerous business in the service of God to deviate from his institutions. We have two institutions. We have the Sabbath and marriage. Those who have to do with God, who is infinite, who explicitly directs in regard to his own worship, should follow the exact course he has prescribed, and not feel at liberty to deviate in the smallest respect, because they think it will answer just as well. God will teach all his creatures that he means just what he says. I don't think there's any way that we can deviate from God's institution on marriage or the Sabbath either. So I'm going to use a quotation here. It's in the little red book here. It's called Special Testimonies to Ministers and Workers. It was arranged and compiled in Australia when Sister White was there. This is on on page 57, and it's about the middle of the book. This paging is not in sequence either. This is the question for us to consider is, have we the attributes of Christ? Excuses are valueless. All circumstances, all appetites and passions are to be servants to the God-fearing man, not ruling over him. The Christian is not to be enslaved by any hereditary or cultivated habits or tendencies. He is to rule the animal passions rather than to be held in bondage of habit. I hope that you can evaluate those quotations. I was reading from Spirit of Apostasy, Book 1, and I think I'll see if I can get in Book 2 now. This is Volume 5 here. I gotta have Book 2, Spirit of Prophecy, in this 221 and 222. Jesus condemns the custom then existing of a man putting away his wife for trivial offenses. This practice led to great wretchedness and crime. Jesus strikes at the primary cause of the laxness with which the marriage relation was held when he condemns the unholy passions which find a marriage institution a barrier to the gratification of their lusts. Christ would have the marriage relation hedged about with judicial restrictions so that there could be no legal separation between husband and wife except save the cause of adultery. Now, when you read this over again, you'll see that it's involved the law. The marriage relation hedged about with judicial, that's according to law, restrictions so that there could be no legal separation between husband and wife save the cause of adultery. It's many who have regarded the commandments as prohibiting actual crimes, but reaching no further now perceive that the law of God should be obeyed in the spirit as well as in the letter. To this manner, Jesus takes up the commandments separately and explains the depth and breadth of their requirements, exposing the fatal mistake of the Jews in their mere outward condemnation. The Adventist people have followed the very same course that the Jews followed. It's the same falling away from their holy calling. Listen to what this says. I'm in Volume 5, and it's on page 680. It is not alone those who openly reject the testimonies, who cherish doubt concerning them, that are on dangerous ground. To disregard like is to reject it. It's inevitable. On the next page, 681. Many are going directly contrary to the light which God has given to his people, because they do not read the books which contain light and knowledge and cautions, reproofs, and warnings. The cares of the world, the love of fashion, and the lack of religion has turned the attention from the light God has so graciously given, while books and periodicals contain error are traveling all over the country. Skepticism and infidelity are increasing everywhere. Lack of the precious, lack so precious coming from the throne of God is hidden under a bushel. God will make his people responsible for this neglect. An account must be rendered to him for every ray of light he has let shine upon our pathway, whether it be has been improved to our advancement in divine things or rejected because it was more disagreeable to follow fashion. Well, let me see. Let's get another quotation here. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And I'm going to read here. It's 9 and 10. Excuse me. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 9 and 10. All right. Know ye not that the unrighteousness shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, neither thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. Now remember what I read. God would have his children know he means exactly what he says. I'd like to turn back now to the third chapter of our 1 Corinthians and read verse 16 and 17. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy. Which temple are ye? It's not hard to evaluate. As sure it is not hard to evaluate. Now let's turn to the seventh chapter. You understand that Paul was never a married man, but he was an apostle. So, and Christ called him for that work. I'm reading the seventh chapter of 1 Corinthians. I'm going to read from verse 1 2:11. Now concerning the things which of you whereof ye wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. Let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. The wife hath no power of her own body, but the husband. And likewise also the husband hath no power of his own body, but the wife. Defraud ye not one another, except it be with consent for a time, that ye may give yourself to fasting and prayer, and come together again, that Satan tempt you not for your inconsistencies. But I speak this by permission, and not by commandment. For I would that all men were even as I myself. But every man hath his proper gift of God, one after this manner, and the other after that. I say therefore to the unmarried and widow, it is good for them to abide even as I. But if they cannot contain, let them marry, for it is better to marry than to burn. And unto the married I command you not, I but the Lord, let not the wife depart from her husband, but and if she depart, let her remain unmarried, or be reconciled to her husband, and let not the husband put away his wife. I think that's very, very plainly spoken. Let's look now at verse 39. The wife is bound by the law as long as her husband liveth. But if her husband be dead, she is at liberty to be married to whom she will, only in the Lord. I think these words are very, very closely connected and very, very easily for us to understand. Let's go back here and Exodus chapter 20. I think you know exactly what I'm going to read here. Exodus chapter 20, and I'm going to read verse 14. I think you'll recognize this. Thou shalt not commit adultery. That's part of God's law and institution. It is as binding as the Sabbath. My, as I said when I started it, this is going to be quite controversial, and some of you may not agree with what I'm trying to teach you. But nevertheless, it's God's Word. Let's see now. I have got two quotations now, and for a week to close. It's Matthew 24, and I'm going to read verse 37, 38, and 39. But as in the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark. Well, I have to read just one more here. I think I did read this, but I'm going to read it again. And it's Spirit of Prophecy, Book 1. And I think I could read another one here, too. The Original Testimony, number 29. And let me read a couple quotations here. It's on page 112. Institutions that are God's instruments to carry forward His work on earth must be sustained. Churches must be erected, schools established, and publishing houses furnished with facilities for doing a great work in the publication of the truth to be sent to all parts of the world. These institutions are ordained of God and shall be sustained by tithe and liberal offerings. Just one more in this book on page 123. In commissioning His disciples to go into all the world, to preach the gospel to every creature, Christ assigned them in the work of spreading the gospel. But while some go forth to preach, He calls upon others to answer to His claims upon them for tithes and offerings, with which to support the ministry and to spread the printed truth all over the land. This is God's means of exalting man. It is just the work which He needs, for it will stir the deepest sympathies of His heart and call into exercise the highest capabilities of the mind. Remember now, I hope you'll review some of these quotations and make yourself familiar. The last one, what a contrast to the course now pursued by parents and children. There are many unhappy marriages because of so much haste. Two unite their interest at the marriage altar by most solemn vows before God, without previously weighing the matter and devoting time to sober reflection and earnest prayer. Many move from impulse. They have no thorough acquaintance with the disposition of each other. They do not realize that the happiness of their life is at stake. Remember, the word whole has been removed in this book. The happiness of their whole life is at stake. If they move wrong in this matter, and their married life proves unfaithful or unhappy, it cannot be taken back. If they find that they are not calculated to make each other happy, they must endure it the best they can. In some instances, the husband proves to be too indolent to provide for his family, and his wife and children suffer. If the ability of such had been proved, it was the custom anciently, before marriage, much misery could have been saved. In the case of Rachel and Leah, Laban selfishly kept the dowry which should have been given to them. They have reference to this when they say he hath sold us and hath quietly devoured our money. Well, we know that story well. I hope that you'll consider this real well, especially the ministry. The ministry is guilty as a gourd. Is that why we don't have any Holy Spirit? That's exactly why. Because even the ministry has not living up to the light. to my mind, I think about this one quotation, and it's in volume 5 of your book, in the 707. I have been shown that many who profess to have a knowledge of present truth know not what they believe. They do not understand the evidence of their faith. They have no just appreciation of the work for the present time. When the time of trial shall come, there are men now preaching to others who will find upon examining the position they hold that there are many things for which they can give no satisfactory answer or reason. Until thus tested, they know not their great in ignorance. And there are many in a church who take it for granted that they understand what they believe. But until controversy arises, they do not know their own weakness. When separated from those of like faith and compelled to stand alone to explain their beliefs, they will be surprised to see how confused are their ideas of what they had believed as truth. Certain it is that there is had been among us a departure from the living God and a turning to men, putting human in the place of divine. God will arouse his people. If other means fail, heresies will come in among us, which will sift them, separate the chaff from the wheat. The Lord calls upon all who believe his word to awake out of sleep. Precious light has come appropriate for this time. On 227, you'll find out what the separation from the chaff, what is the chaff, and what is the wheat. Well, God bless you as you study God's word, and I hope that we have done some good here this afternoon.